I am a neuroscientist, and I have been working for 35 years investigating the dopaminergic transmission in the rat brain, and I was an happy neuroscientist. But for about 8 years ago, I was contacted by a group of French psychologists because I was an expert in the field of dopamine. They asked me whether it is true that ADHD is caused by a lack of dopamine. And to their surprise, I was not able to answer their question because I was focused on the basic aspects. But then I started to read everything about the dopaminergic transmission related to ADHD, and I reached to the conclusion that this hypothesis is weak. I have published this in Trends in Neuroscience. But at the same time, I realized that it is a dogma. I realized that it is written everywhere in the textbooks, in the newspaper, for example, in the very famous, popular newspaper in England, The Independent, in February 2011. Scientists believe ADHD is caused by a lack of dopamine, the mood-regulating brain chemical, so clinicians prescribe drugs such as Ritalin to stimulate dopamine release. And therefore, I was concerned with this discourse, and therefore I decided to stop experimenting the rat brain to move my research interest why we have this gap between the scientific observations on the one hand and what it is written in the media on the other hand. And in the first part of my talk, I would like to give you to describe you the most prominent types of distortions. The two first types occur inside primary scientific studies. Give me an example. This is an article published by a very famous group, Nora Volkoff, and the title says, "Depressed dopamine activity in caudate of adults with ADHD." In the abstract again, these results provide evidence of depressed dopamine activity in ADHD. But inside the results section, they describe two sets of data which are quite contradictory, and they know this. They have written in the results section, "We cannot rule out the possibility that the blunted dopamine response to methylphenidate in subjects with ADHD could reflect higher baseline dopamine tone." But nevertheless, they decide to select between two hypotheses, and they put forward the hypothesis that they thought was more appealing. And therefore, it is as no surprise, this is this hypothesis, a deficit of dopamine, which is expressed in the media. For example, when the Wall Street Journal echoed on this study, they said a team led by Nora Volkoff documented decreased dopamine activity in the brains of group of adults with ADHD. We have checked 40 media reports about this scientific article, and all of them echoed on this misleading conclusion. The second type of misrepresentation inside primary scientific publications, again, consists to put in the summary a conclusion which is very strong and to omit to give the raw data. Let's examine an example. This is a review article in which it is said two meta-analyses confirmed an association with ADHD of ADHD with allele of the gene coding for the dopaminergic D4 receptor. Okay, but what are the data? This gene, there are several alleles, and one allele called 7-repeat is present in 23% of ADHD children and in 17% of healthy children. This is the largest association between a gene and ADHD. What we did is to test all the summaries in all articles dealing with ADHD and this 7-repeat allele. we tested 159 relevant summaries, and 80% omitted to say that either the raw data are not very impressive or that it confers a small risk. All of them say that there is a strong association. And therefore, as no surprise, in the media, for example, in the health guide of the New York Times, variations in genes that regulate specific dopamine receptors have been identified in a high proportion of people with ADHD. Now, let's examine another type of distortion which occurs inside the scientific literature as a rule, citation distortion. I recommend you the lecture of this article by Greenberg, How Citation Distortions Create Unfounded Authority, Analysis of a Citation Network. Let's examine an example again. This statement by Iverson and Iverson has been written in the scientific literature hundreds of times. The effectiveness of a dopamine-based stimulant drugs in ADHD treatment suggests an underlying dopamine hypofunctional state. However, it has been demonstrated as early as 1978 and published in Science by a very famous group that this inference is weak. Indeed, the psychostimulant induces exactly the same effect in children diagnosed with ADHD and in so-called healthy children. However, this article by Rapoport and co-workers is never cited in the context of this aforementioned inference. And I would like to stress another article by Wolochin and co-workers about press release. They demonstrated that when a press release describes accurately the data which are in a scientific publication, the newspaper articles that echoed on this scientific observation are accurate too. But when the press release are not accurate, the newspaper are not accurate too. And the press release are written not by journalists, but by scientific institutions. But in my opinion, the most important source of distortion is related to publication bias. What it is? Let's examine an example again about ADHD. Of course, Ritalin is an inhibitor of a dopamine transporter. Therefore, many groups in the world try to demonstrate that there is something wrong with a dopamine transporter in the brain of adults diagnosed with ADHD. And the first publication on this topic answered, yes, of course, the level of a dopamine transporter in adults with ADHD is 70% higher than in healthy adults. And therefore, this was a marvelous, it is a breakthrough. It explains the cause of the disease, it explains why the medication is beneficial. It corrects the imbalance. But it is wrong. It has been demonstrated by subsequent studies that there is no differences between the people diagnosed with ADHD and healthy people concerning the dopaminergic transmission. You can see there, but, yes, the meta-analysis, no effect at all. But is it shocking? On the scientific point of view, it is not shocking. Scientists put hypotheses, then test hypotheses, but in most cases, hypotheses are wrong. This is not shocking. Initial studies, in most cases, give a much larger report, a much larger effect than the subsequent studies. This is normal too. When a scientific group try to demonstrate an association between a parameter and a disease, when there is no effect, they don't publish. Therefore, it is expected, it is the logical process of publication that initial studies always report a larger effect, almost always. The problem is mediatization. because it was a big discovery in 1999 that ADHD people have a higher level of dopamine transporter, it has been published in a very famous journal, The Lancet, with an impact factor of more than 30. The subsequent studies that said that there is no effect were published in a peer journal, but with a smaller impact factor, therefore less prestigious journals. And as a consequence, newspaper articles echoed on the initial study, but not at all. Therefore, for example, the Doherty study received 36 newspaper articles in English during the week after its publication. Whereas the subsequent study received no covering except this one, three newspaper articles, and none of these three said that the initial study was refuted. This is a general rule. This is exactly the same story with the seven repeat allele. The initial study was reported a much larger effect than the subsequent one. And to demonstrate the generality of this, we investigated in the reverse way. We looked at all newspaper articles echoing on news or scientific studies about ADHD during the decade from 1990 to 1999. And we found that 47 scientific publications were echoed, and we focused on the top 10, those 10 articles that received the largest newspaper coverage during this decade. Interestingly enough, among the top 10, you find the Doherty study, you find the Lau study about the D4 gene. Interestingly enough, among the top 10, you have seven initial studies. And all these seven initial studies have been either refuted or strongly attenuated. To go to end with this point, I would like to stress a study by Caspi and co-workers, which had an enormous impact. It is a paper published in Science in 2003 about interaction between gene and stress as a risk factor for depression. In this study, Caspi and co-workers, it is a follow-up of 845 adults for 5 years, and they claimed that adults bearing the short form of a gene coding for the serotonin transporter were more at risk when exposed to stress of developing depression. First of all, what is the effect size? The effect size of the genetic susceptibility expressed as odd ratio is 1.3. There is a recent meta-analysis about the effect of child maltreatment as a risk factor about depression, and the amplitude of this risk is much larger, first of all. The odd ratio is 3, therefore the environmental effect is 10 times larger than the genetic effect, as according to Caspi, of course. But Caspi's study has been refuted. It has been refuted, for example, by this study with, it is exactly the same kind of study, a follow-up of 4,000 patients for years, adults for years. And there is a meta-analysis which has been published in 2009. There is absolutely no significant effect of genetic susceptibility concerning depression and this gene. I would like to stress and to recommend you this article by Keller and co-workers. They take into account all the studies about genetic susceptibility towards so-called psychiatric disorders. And they conclude, this is their conclusion. To date, scientists have not convincingly demonstrated that any genetic susceptibility is robust. In conclusion, of this first part of my talk, neuroscientists, scientific editors, scientific institutions, and the process of publication do contribute to distort neuroscience findings into misleading conclusions in the media. Journalists only echo on this already distorted discourse. And therefore, this is my first suggestion regarding what we can do to help the society to reimagine psychiatry. We have to get in contact with journalists. We have to discuss with them. We have to inform them about the different types of distortion. According to my own experience with French journalists, this type of argument is well received. But what are the consequences of this communication distortion? If we consider ADHD, this discourse about the involvement of, for example, the hypothesis of a dopamine deficit, it twisted the evidence in favor of medication. Whereas we have empirical evidence that the medication with psychostimulant is not effective at the long term. We know from epidemiologic studies that children diagnosed with ADHD are at risk of further development of underachievement, toxicomania, behavioral problems. But it has been clearly demonstrated by a very strong study that it is not beneficial at all to give medication in the hope to solve this problem. Therefore, this is the first point. The scientific discourse is abusive. It distorts, it twisted the evidence. But the worst point, in my opinion, is that it is about prevention. For example, I have found in the Health Central website, which is an official website in the US, there is no way to prevent ADHD. ADHD is a neurobiological condition. It is hereditary, say the experts. And this is wrong. We have very strong evidence that there are several environmental factors which are strongly associated with ADHD. For example, premature birth. The rate of premature birth in European countries ranges from 5 to 8. In the US, it is 13. Second point, excessive TV watching between years 1 and 3. Then, child maltreatment, sexual abuse, low economic level of the family, low academic level of the mother, teenager pregnancy. In the European countries, we have between 4 and 10 births per 1,000 teenagers. In the US, it is 42. In the US, 10% of the children are born from teenager mother. Therefore, health and social policies may contribute to decrease this problem. And to end with this point, I would like to cite Daniel Luchin. Daniel Luchin was in charge of public psychiatry in the state of Illinois, and he said, "For almost every mental illness, the prevalence is greater or the prognostic is poorer as you descend the socioeconomic ladder. I would argue that it is to avoid accepting the implications of this particular vexing aspect of illness that attention is usually focused on biological, not social factors." But finally, I would like to take into account scientific observation on the opposite way. I would like to develop the view that genetic studies actually question mainstream psychiatry. Of course, I will not develop all the scientific studies about genetic risk of psychiatric disorders, but I would like to focus on copy number variant of a large size. It consists ever in deletion or duplication of fragment of DNA, and all of us concerning small fragments, we have these copy number variants. But if we consider large copy number variants, They are very rare in the healthy population, but much, much more frequent in the population with severe intellectual disability. And half of these copy number variants are de novo mutations. This means that they occur in the patient, but not in his or her parents. And therefore, this explains why, concerning intellectual disability and some cases of autism and schizophrenia, father older than 50 is a risk factor. But I would like to point out how much is explained by these copy number variants. Concerning, if we focus on these 16 copy number variants which have been identified by Malhotra and co-workers, they explain 3.2% of the case of intellectual disability. They explain 2.1% of the case of autism. They explain 1.9% of schizophrenia, but they explain almost no case at all about bipolar depression. There is absolutely no association between ADHD and this copy number variant, and no association too with depression, unipolar depression. Therefore, in my opinion, what it is interesting here is it is the relative amplitude of these effects. And it's why I would like to conclude with a sentence by Sonuga Barke, who is a very well-respected psychiatrist in Great Britain. Now, all but the most dogged of the genetic determinists have revised their view of the primacy of genetic factors so as to encompass a central role for the environment in the development of mental disorders. And therefore, what we have to conclude is that we have now a big change in the term of in the history of psychiatry. During the two last centuries, psychiatry was oriented by a misconception, because it is full and obvious that mental disorders run in families. It has been claimed that it is caused by genetic problems. But now we know for sure that it's not the case. It is wrong. And therefore, we have to take into account this. And I would like to, therefore, say that we have to distinguish clearly between a few medical problems, such as intellectual disability, some cases of autism, some cases of schizophrenia, but not all of them, which might be mainly caused by biological problems. For example, autism, there is a very strong risk factor, which is caused by a deficit of vitamin D during the prenatal period. And therefore, there is a cure for this. But on the other hand, we have to consider completely differently so-called alleged disorders, ADHD, anxiety, depression, bipolar type 2, anorexia, and even people who are said to be schizophrenic because they hear voice. In my opinion, I see all these, if we consider these so-called disorders, we have no biological markers, the diagnosis is poorly reliable and have no scientific validity, and the psychotropic drugs are not very effective. Therefore, I see no benefit to consider most alleged mental disorders as brain disease requiring a diagnosis and a medical care. We have to reimagine psychiatry and mental health care. And with French colleagues, we have discussed what we can suggest to this audience. And we made a few suggestions. First of all, I consider that all civilizations in the past have to restricted the exposure to psychotropic compounds. And in our civilization, psychotropic drugs are too widely prescribed by general practitioners. That's what we have to do. In France, it is our suggestion. We think that psychotropic medication should be prescribed only by a medical doctor, psychiatrist. Treatment duration and dosage should be reduced as much as possible. But concerning diagnosis, in most cases, a diagnosis does not guide psychotherapeutic practice. Thus, most psychotherapies should be delivered without any diagnosis. Medical studies are not appropriate to train psychotherapists. Therefore, medical doctors practicing psychotherapies need a specific training and should not prescribe medication. On the spot, psychotherapeutic care should be provided to face crisis in hospitals, police station, school sick room, and psychotherapies should be provided for free through public health service in crisis for everybody complaining for depression during at least for the first sessions and as long as needed for people with a low economic status. And I would like to acknowledge my co-workers and my institutional support. Thank you for your attention.